All right. Hello, everyone. Thank you for the introductions. We're not talking about AI and monkeys, but I think we're talking about a topic that's probably more fun, fandom, specifically K-pop. And today I have here two lovely gentlemen to talk about some successful strategies that they've done when they try to cater to K-pop fans in Southeast Asia. So to kick it off, I have a very important question. Are you a K-pop fan? Number one. And the second is, what's the difference with a fan? Like, why are they different from your typical consumer profile? And for this, I'd love to give it to Dennis to start us with.
Okay. Hi, good afternoon, and I'm happy to be here. The honest answer is I'm not a K-pop fan. I think I'm one of the minority not to be in the movement. But that is actually one thing interesting as well with fandom. Fandoms normally operate mutually exclusive to each other. And, you know, in a fandom, there's a specific culture, there's specific language, and normally that language stays within the fandom and is not basically transferable to another fandom. And for a marketeer, that actually gives a very good opportunity, but also a good challenge, right? How do you penetrate that fandom in order to bring to life brand stories in a way that's basically relevant and resonant within that tribe? So yes, the answer is I'm not a K-pop fan, but that's basically something that we tried to crack when we worked with YouTube in landing this very good campaign that we did multi-market across Southeast Asia.
I mean, we're using K-pop as the vehicle here, but fandom is a psychology across many different types of interests. So for you, Rushit, same question. And I also know you just came from Burning Man. I don't think there's K-pop happening there. So what's the difference between a fan or a fandom than your normal consumer profile?
Sure. Thanks so much. So I'm a K-pop fan professionally, maybe not personally. So let me take a step back, right? I think we see fandoms in many different ways. You could see small micro communities of fans. It could be fans of sneakers, could be fans of fragrances, or you could see larger fan communities. And I think the largest fan communities that we see on YouTube typically are around sports, gaming, and music. And when we come to K-pop, within music, it is probably one of the largest fan bases, right? And what's interesting is that the way the fans engage within the K-pop space is slightly different. I think fans truly see themselves as incredibly passionate tribe members. So there's the BTS army, the Blink, Larger, and there are many, many different K-pop fan clubs. And each of them, you know, believe that that's a part of their personality. And I think, you know, one of the things that Jonathan said in his session earlier, which I think stuck with me as a marketer, was that a super fan is likely to spend 3x as much as a regular consumer. Now, I think that, to me, is gold from a marketer's perspective. And I think that's what makes it incredibly important to engage with these super fans within any genre, but within K-pop, it gives you that wide reach across Southeast Asia, which not many other genres do.
I have a follow-up to you. I know we've been saying K-pop fan, which is like individual person, but actually the way we describe it is a tribe, it is community. And you mentioned, you know, that they're more likely to purchase, and within, I assume, is a very primed environment of a group of friends. You're like, hey, can you buy this and that? Can you talk through why that tribe will make a difference in marketing performance?
Yeah, so look, I think the way we see it, right, we see fans engaged largely, and I'll talk a little bit from a YouTube perspective because we're looking at that very often. When do we see these fan communities really pop up? It's largely around moments. Now, some of those moments could be happening on YouTube, like Blackpink launching a new music video. Pink Venom, when it dropped, was 96 million views in 24 hours. BTS Butter was 104 million views in 24 hours. And you see that it's actually a lot of these fans that are building the hype around those moments. They're actually engaging communities to make sure that their idols are actually right up there. So I think the way they are dedicated to seeing their idols succeed is really interesting. And from a marketer's perspective, I think that's an incredible, you know, community to engage with at that moment. Because you could see trends of what they're doing before, during, and after those specific moments. And I think one of the things that we worked on together was actually interesting because the moment didn't happen on YouTube. We actually engaged with fans around, Blackpink was doing their tour around Southeast Asia. And we engaged with fans around the tour because we knew that these communities would be coming onto YouTube and creating content, which we could then leverage for a brand.
That's a good segue into talking about the campaign. And before we go into the weeds, Dennis, I'm very curious, what was the brief that you brought to Rushit? And this was a pilot program, and I'm pretty sure everyone in the room here would probably want to pilot something similar. So can you talk through what were the expectations, the objectives?
Maybe before I go to the details of the brief, let me talk about a principle that we apply in Unilever Beauty and Wellbeing. And that principle, that marketing principle, is what we call Others Say. Others Say is our new take on influencer marketing. And the nice thing about Others Say is that it doesn't have the word influencer and doesn't have the word marketing as well. Because by Others Say is just simply using the voices of others in order for you to convey a brand message. And by having that kind of new perspective, we tend to open up now to more voices, right? So for example, we do have our own dermatologist, professional practitioner engagement plan. We also have engagement plans with government. And one of them is basically Fandom. And during the time, of course, we know that Blackpink will be having its big, highly anticipated Southeast Asia tour. And we said that this is a moment that we cannot let go. And of course, we reach out to Google. And you know, the good thing is that, you know, we learn as we start the campaign, because the initial proposal of Google is the usual lineups, roadblocks. It's basically a media play, just making sure that your ads are basically there in all of Blackpink relevant channels and videos, right? And then that's where we said, like, I think we can do something else, right? We know exactly that Blinks are highly engaged and highly, you know, I would say hooked into this moment in Southeast Asia. And what we said is, you know, instead of just doing a normal media reach through roadblocks and lineups, why don't we actually transition from using Brand Say to Others Say? And try to look for these fans, this, or leverage on this fandom, and try to basically create content through their lens and through their own language. And that's where we had this very good partnership with Google to really look into the top, I would say, influencer within the fandom. And that's where we saw that, you know, sometimes, you know, the fan that you need to basically tap in the fandom is not the one that's highest reaching. You know, surprisingly, for example, moving away from Blackpink, like, for example, in the Philippines, the president of the BTS official fan club is a lawyer. And that lawyer, of course, being a lawyer, doesn't have that much social following. But that's the person that you need to basically influence to seed all of this information for the fandom to erupt. And that's what we did through the help of YouTube. Really look for those, I would say, influencer or the super fan within the fandom, and try to basically leverage that whole ecosystem of content creation. And we learned a lot, you know, and that was also the first time for Google, and it was also the first time for us to do it. And there was a lot of discomfort at the beginning, because suddenly you don't have control on what content will come out. But what we realized is that we were able to arrest, you know, that moment in culture, and that's where we saw a lot of engagement come through, you know, even over the roof, based from our, you know, previous experience. So that's basically how it happened. So it was not a brief that, you know, leverage on fandom. We actually stumbled upon it together with Google, which is a good partnership with them. Yeah.
Lawyer who's also president of BTS. Is that the moderator before me? Anyway, that's a good segue into, you know, the next question for you. And I wanted to say one thing. What I love what you said is that it's not influencer marketing, right? And once you remove that jargon, actually, it opens up the box for innovation. And so from a media perspective, Rushit, how do you plan a sponsorship package for that? Like, what are you doing differently? And how is this growth in fandom changing the way media is done?
Yeah. Look, it was a really interesting challenge for us, right? It's not that we obviously do creator marketing, and we connect brand partners with creators all the time. But briefs are usually a little bit more straightforward. Like, okay, if you're looking to drive reach, there might be creators that give you the viewership, and you have a list of creators that you could potentially work with. If you're looking to go with certain genres, like food recipe videos, tutorial videos, there are very clear creators that you could work with. What was interesting about this brief is we had to not just identify the creators that would be relevant for the brand and product category and for the message that they wanted to share, but also they needed to be super fans. And I think that layer of complexity is the reason we were a bit hesitant initially, because we had to then really, you know, work hard to find those creators. But what was interesting and the reason that we decided to take on this pilot was because we know that fandoms, and like I said earlier, fandoms are an incredibly important consumer profile and a consumer group that we need to go after. So if we could figure out how to do this well, then we can figure out how we can actually unlock fandom conversations across various genres, like I said before. Could be sports, could be gaming, or could be others as well. So which is why the reason we decided to take this on and kind of take that challenge was because we wanted to evolve that sponsorship package beyond taking over the channel, beyond doing a roadblock, beyond doing a lineup is essentially when you're targeting all of the K-pop videos on the platform. How do you go beyond that? And creator marketing was our way to go beyond that, and then working a little harder to identify the right creators to address the brand brief was what made it interesting. And that's how the sponsorship packages are evolving. It's not just around those moments. It's what you're doing before, during, and after those moments across the ecosystem on YouTube.
You wouldn't want to add, Dennis? Oh, you gestured at me, so I thought you wanted to. But, you know, let's talk a little bit about best practice, because what I'm hearing from both of you is that it's a pilot program, so much more complexity. You know, you have to release brand control. But if I stay with you a little bit more, Rushit, you know, there's creators for always on strategy, but for this campaign, you had a very specific kind of profile. So what advice would you give to the marketers in the room on how do you pick those types of creators for different things?
I think we were very fortunate, firstly, to have a client like Dennis on this one, because Dennis is a storyteller himself, you know, and he understood the value of us letting the creators be authentic and actually engage with fans. It's not, being honest, it's not always as easy a conversation. It's not all, marketers don't always see it that way, because the focus tends to be on the brand message. Whereas in this case, it was, what's that creator's voice? How is that creator influencing other super fans? And how can we become a part of that voice? And I think that's what made it interesting. And that's also the reason we decided to dive in, because we knew that we had a partnership where we could engage with those creators in the right way.
I think one best practice that we saw is, of course, this is normally already, you know, replayed in so many forums, but, you know, when it comes to creator marketing, you really need to let go. You know, normally when we do write a brief, there's so many, I would say, mandatories, you know, hold this bottle or maybe put this line in. But one thing that we decided from this campaign is really to let go of that and really let the creator do his or her thing. So that's basically one. And I think I mentioned already about making sure that you have the right tools backed by data to really choose for the super fans. That's another thing. And one thing also interesting with this campaign is that we did it multi-market, because we know Blink will be going around Southeast Asia, so we leverage on several markets. And this is where, you know, understanding consumers, you know, basically the core of marketing really comes in. For example, in the Philippines, we realized that most of the super fans are basically into music. So that was the content slant that we used. So we actually let a lot of people actually sang, dance into a Blackpink song and try to integrate, you know, the brand message that we would like to deliver. But in Malaysia, it's very much different. In Malaysia, they're pretty much focused on beauty, how they prepared for the concert, what to wear, how I'm going to style my hair, which pretty much fits the portfolio that we have for Unilever Beauty and Wellbeing. So that was quite straightforward. But if you look at it, we need to let creators and also the fans be themselves, and especially for fandom, because they're not really social influencers. They're there because they love Blink. They're Blinks. They love Blackpink. And most of them are really not there for them to show to show and get more likes and more engagement. But they're really there because of their passion for Blackpink. And therefore, you need to respect that and not cross the line and let them create the content that they know will resonate within their own fandom.
I've got about 5 minutes left. I've got two questions. The first one is, it's so great to hear from you, Dennis, that we all want control, right? That you're talking about releasing control, got to be let the consumer or the creator have their voice or their fan. But I guess from a brand perspective, how do you still get your message across? Like, yeah. What's that one thing that you need to make sure is still there?
This is another, I would say, hard but intense but fruitful discussion with Google.
It was fun.
It was fun, yeah. Measurement, right? So we know that we're going beyond lineups, roadblocks. It's not a media play. And therefore, we really challenged Google to say that, you know, it's not reach that we want. What we want is what we call message association. Because in working with fandom, or maybe with creators and influencers, you don't know whether did they engage because they're funny, or did they engage because your brand is there, right? So at the end of the day, we need to basically link it back to the message, not even brand association, but message association. And then Google actually approached and said, like, you know, unfortunately, it's a custom brand lift study. We don't have that, right? And I think it was like a good discussion with Google. We even elevated it to global to say, like, you know, can you open a custom brand lift study for this? Because this is really the number one metric that we would like to drive. And Google actually made it happen. And true enough, to our hypothesis, you know, if we compare, the campaigns exposed versus non-exposed, fandom versus non-fandom, I would say the message association is very, very high, meaning they actually got, you know, what we would like them to take. For example, for this campaign, we really we heroed Sunsilk as the brand, and they were not just able to enjoy because it's basically, you know, they saw someone who's part of their fandom, but they also got that it's, you know, it's sponsored by Sunsilk, but they also got, you know, the message of fragrant hair. So that's a very good intersection when it comes to really measuring whether you have added value to the fandom and whether the brand also got value out of it.
Great client. I mean, release control, it's not about reach, it's about, you know, those word associations. Again, taking a more nuanced, thoughtful approach. And we have about 2 minutes, so the last question's for you, Rushit. You know, WARC is all about marketing effectiveness. So this is a pilot program.
Yeah.
We want to ensure the success of this for other markets, for other brands, for the people in this room. So how should you measure success for something like this?
So, I mean, for us, it was, so look, I'm going to put my sales hat on for a minute. Of course, when we're getting into a conversation like that, client validation like this is exactly what you're striving for, right? So being able to prove that pilot and being able to prove that your platform is effective, that the creators on your platform are effective and actually driving business results and driving sales is incredible validation, right? So that was the big tick for us, and that's something that worked. But I think looking at it more strategically, because there's no point in doing such things like this that's so heavy lift as a one-off. So for us, it was how do you prove scalability and how do you create a pilot that you can then take learnings from and actually go beyond a K-pop fandom? And I think that's what was interesting for us. Because we saw that by engaging with creators around these big moments, there is an opportunity for us to open up those sorts of packages and those sorts of opportunities for our brand partners. And we're starting to do more of that now. So we've started to create more fandom opportunities around music, around gaming. Hopefully I can put Dennis on the spot and make sure that he's doing a few more fandom packages in the future.
Yes, we're actually live right now with in Vietnam for June Cook. So we're not staying with the pilot. We're now actually rolling it out.
Coldplay is coming to town. Taylor Swift is coming to town. There's a lot going on.
I think I need to get access to all of these things as part of moderating this panel. And we have about 30 seconds left, so I'm going to sneak in a sneaky question. With you, Rushit, we talked about earlier how this was not your traditional media play. It was kind of culture-first play into, you know, reaching your audience. Can you talk a little bit about why that shift's important?
I think that shift's important because you need to go beyond just those reach metrics, right? And I think it's if you want to resonate with those audiences, you got to be speaking their language, and you got to be speaking in the language that they that is appreciated, right? At the end of the day, when we talk about super fans, again, I'm going to come back to that metric earlier that they are actually now driving purchase decisions more than regular consumers, right? Which is why it's important to engage with them. But you can't engage with them with your regular creatives, with your regular marketing. They want to hear about what they are passionate about. And I think speaking to them in that language is incredibly important. And I think working with them is even more important, right? So I think when we spoke to Dennis, it was, we engage with the artists, we do that, right? And there's value in that. There's also a value in engaging directly with the superfan. And I think that's what worked really well for us.
Awesome. On that note, thank you so much to both of you. Let's just give them a round of applause.